Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture series of compiler design. I am your instructor Kinjal Patel, and the topics to be covered in this lecture are peephole optimization and loops in a flow graph. So first, what is peephole optimization? So it is a simple and effective technique for locally improving target code. Means peephole optimization is used to generate the code efficiently. So this technique is applied to improve the performance of the target program by examining the short sequence of target instructions, and that we are examining the short sequence of target instructions is known as a peephole. So replacing these instructions by shorter and faster sequence whenever possible. So peephole is a small moving window on the target program. Now we are applying this peephole to different sequence of a program, and that is known as a peephole optimization. So there are different techniques of peephole optimization which we will learn in detail. So first technique of peephole optimization is redundant loads and stores. So redundant loads and stores can be eliminated in following type of transformation. For example, there is one instruction move R0, X, and there is other instruction move x, R0. So we can eliminate the second instruction since x is already in R0. So this is how we can perform the redundant instruction elimination using peephole optimization. Okay, now next technique is flow of control optimization. So the unnecessary jump can be eliminated in either the intermediate code or the target code by the following type of peephole optimizations. We can replace the jump sequence. So here is the example, go to L1 and then L1 says that go to L2. So here we can eliminate this go to L1 sequence. We can directly jump toward L2 because the go to L1 and then from L1 to L2, this go to L1 jump is unnecessary. We can directly jump toward L2. So it may be possible to eliminate this statement L1 go to L2 provided it is preceded by an unconditional jump. So similarly, this sequence can be replaced by, here is the example that if A less than B, then go to L1 and then L1 says that go to L2. So here we can directly says that if A less than B, then directly jump toward go to L2. We need not to jump toward L1 and then L2. We can directly jump toward L2. Now third technique is algebraic simplification. So peephole optimization is an effective technique for algebraic simplification. For example, if the statement is x equals to x plus 0, then that statement can be eliminated because the evaluation of that expression will not change the result value of x. So we need not to write this statement x equals to x plus 0 because the result will not get changed. Same way x equals to x star 1. So here the result of this expression will not change the value of x. So no need to perform this expression and no need to execute these two statements. So we can eliminate this type of algebraic expression using peephole optimization. Now fourth technique is reduction in strength. So certain machine instructions are cheaper than the other. In order to improve the performance of intermediate code, we can replace these instructions by equivalent cheaper instruction. For example, x square is cheaper than x star x. So we can reduce the equation using the lower priority operator. So when we can get the same result using lower priority operator, then we need to use the lower priority operator rather than the higher priority operator. So here we can use x square rather than x star x, which is cheaper than the x star x. Okay, similarly, addition and subtraction are cheaper than the multiplication and division because addition and subtraction has a lower priority, so they are lower strength operators. So when we can get the same result using addition and subtraction, then we should use addition and subtraction rather than the multiplication and division. So we can add effectively addition and subtraction for multiplication and division. Then Next technique is machine idioms. So the Turkish instructions have equivalent machine instructions for performing some expressions. So we can replace these target instructions by equivalent machine instructions in order to improve the instruction efficiently. Okay, so we can change the order in which we can get the efficient and effective result. So example is that some machines have auto increment and auto decrement addressing modes. So we need not to write the expression for this, that x equals to x plus 1 or I equals to I plus 1. We need not to write this statement like this, but we can directly auto increment the expression like I plus plus, I minus minus. So these expressions have lower addressing mode. So we should use the auto increment and auto decrement instructions rather than the whole expression I equals to I plus 1 or I equals to I minus 1 respectively. Okay. Now next topic is loops in a flow graph. So till now here we have learned the different techniques of people optimization. Now we'll learn the different loops of a flow graph. So first loop is dominators. So in a flow graph, a node D dominates N if every path to node N from initial node goes through D only. Means we can say that one node D will dominate node N if every path from node N from initial node goes through D only. So it should go through D only, then only D will dominate N. Okay, so we can denote this D dominated N using D dominate N. Now every initial node dominates all the remaining nodes in a flow graph. So this is the first rule to determine the dominators, that every initial node will dominate all the remaining node in the flow graph. Then second rule is that every node dominates itself. So every node will dominate itself and every initial node will dominate remaining node in the flow graph. Now here is the flow graph. So here node 1 is initial node, so it will dominate the all the node of the flow graph. As one node is initial node, so it will dominate the remaining node in the flow graph, and one is a node, so it will also dominate itself. So 1 will dominate 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Same way, if we want to find the dominators of 2, so we'll see the subtree of 2. So subtree of 2 contains 3, 4, 5 nodes. So we need to check that from node 1, if there is path which goes from 2 only, then only we can say that 2 will dominate 3. Okay, so there is only one path from 1 toward 3 and which is goes from 2, so we can say that 2 dominates 3. Same way, if you want to check for 4, so we need to check that if there are more than 2 paths but all the paths goes from 2, then we can say that 2 dominates 4. So here there is only one path from 1 and which goes from 2, so we can say that 2 dominates 4. Okay, now we want to check for 5. So there are two paths from starting node. One is 1, 2, 3, 5 and the second path is 1, 2, 4, 5. So these are the two paths. Now we need to check that from these two paths, if both paths goes from node 2, then we can say that 2 will dominate 5. Okay, so the one path contains value 1, 2, 3, 5 and the second path contains value 1, 2, 4, 5, which goes from the common node 2. So we can say that this 2 dominates 5. So 2 dominates 3, 4 and 5. Then natural loops. So these are the two essential property of a natural loop, that a loop must have single entry point called the header and this point dominates all nodes in the loop. Okay, and there must be at least one way to iterate the loop. So here is the graph. So here 1 is the header. Now 6 to 1 is the natural loop, because A loop must have single entry point. So here one has a single entry point which is header, and this point dominates all the node in the loop, and this point also pointing the all the nodes in the loop, and there must be at least one way to iterate loop. So the one way to iterate loop is 6 to 1, so that's why 6 to 1 is a natural loop. And next is inner loop. So the inner loop is a loop that contains no other loop. Okay, so here is the graph. So there are two backward which are containing the loop. One is from 5 to 1 and the other is from 4 to 2. But 5 to 1 also contains the inner loop which is from 4 to 1. So from 2 to 3, 3 to 4 and 4 to 1 containing the loop. So as in this loop there is no other loop, so we can say that 2, 3, 4 is the inner loop. Okay, so here the inner loop is from 4 to 2, that means the edge given by 2, 3, 4. There are two loops which are containing loop. One is from 5 to 1 and the other is from 4 to 2. But 5 to 1 also contains 4 to 2. So we can say that the 4 to 2 is an inner loop because inside 4 to 2 there is no other loop. Then next is pre-headers. So several transformation requires the move statement before the header. Okay, so therefore begin treatment of a loop L by creating a new block called the pre-header. The pre-header has only the header as a successor. So here we can apply or we can add one pre-header block so that if we are making any changes, then we'll make that it to pre-header and it will not get change in the different blocks of the program. That if we are making change in the pre-header, then we are making change only in the one block. That will not affect the other block of the code. Now next is the reducible flow graph. So reducible graph is a flow graph in which there are two types of edges, forward edges and backward edges. Okay, so these edges have following properties. The forward edge forms an acyclic graph and the back edges are such edges whose head dominates their tail. Okay, so here the graph which is reducible flow graph because there are forward edges and backward edges. So here forward edges forms a acyclic graph and back edges are the edges such that head dominates tail. Here from 5 to 1 there is loop, so where 1 is head and 5 is tail. So this is generating the loop, that's why this flow graph is reducible flow graph, that we can reduce this flow graph by eliminating this edge. Next is non-reducible flow graph. So non-reducible flow graph is a flow graph in which there are no back edges because the back edges which are creating the loop iteration. So if there are no back edges in the loop, then we can say that this graph is non-reducible graph, and forward edges may produce cycle in the graph. So here is the graph of non-reducible flow graph, that from 1 to 2, 2 to 3 and 3 to 2. So here this graph is non-reducible graph because there is no back edges in this graph. Okay, here there is one edge which is from 3 to 2, but there are edges, but that edges is between the two child. There is no back edges, that there is no edge from child to parent. So this graph is also creating cycle, but it is not a reducible flow graph. So in this lecture we have learned the different techniques of pifol optimization and different loops of a flow graph. Thank you.